Gosh, you imagine the future workplace where, in fact, someone is told that they actually need to take time off.
So we can have beautiful lives, but we have to be the ones that proactively make that happen.
So one of the things we're very passionate about right now is mental health.
If we look at mental health developments, the past 10 years and the projections for the next 10 years, I think one of the greatest gifts you can give to your children or to the young generations is that they can deal with uncertainty, yeah. That they're agile, mm-hmm. In the sense of, you know, the job you might be in higher education for it might disappear, but then are you agile enough to switch jobs? Are you open to a lot of changes? And are you able to stay mentally healthy when you cannot find the perfect job, when you cannot find the perfect partner, when your life is not perfect? And if you look at, especially among youngsters in their 20s, burnouts, depression, suicide rates, it's not looking good. Yeah, that is the emotion AI, the emotion artificial intelligence. So that is technology actually measuring how we're feeling right now. Yeah. And this is already, you know, there are quite a few companies working on this, and it's already being used in practice. At this moment, Amazon is working on a wearable that can measure your emotions. So your Alexa or Apple with Siri, that your digital assistant can hear from your voice how you're feeling and then use that to customize and personalize. Emotion AI is coming, but it will be only a tool. So many people say, is it going to replace all, you know, human emotion interaction? And that, you know, we're, you know, is that then going to replace many of the human interaction we have? No, I don't think so. It'd be a tool.
Yeah. But let's think that if I'm your GP of the future and you've got measurables and things coming in and they're saying to me that Mike's blood pressure's been spiking a bit lately and he could be considered hypertensive, or Mike's looking a little stressed of late, and then it comes back to you and intuitively says, Mike, you need to actually consult your clinician.
Yeah.
The clinician's already aware of this. The dashboard's there. All of the information is needed to say, we're starting here. We're not starting way back here, saying, now how are you feeling? I don't have to ask that question. Yeah. Gee, it appears that you're actually, your blood pressure's up and you're a bit stressed at the moment.
Let's cut to the chase.
And then I can turn back and say, well, the data actually says that you're showing spikes of blood pressure here and here and here. Mm. And that seems to be coinciding with these particular events. Or your sleep cycle's gone way off, and this is actually indicating you've probably got depression, Mike. Now, we need to talk about this, and we need to deal with this. So that's assisting the human touch to actually add that to it.
So one of the things we're very passionate about right now is mental health, both internally for Atlassians, but also for our customers, which is how do we manage the fact that the average working week in most Western countries is increasing, despite Tim Ferriss's wonderful books about short working weeks. The average knowledge worker like me and you is working longer hours, and the tasks are getting more complex. Automation is taking the simple and mundane tasks. We have been left with more complex work and we're doing more of it. That sounds like a mental health epidemic, right, waiting to happen.
Absolutely.
And yet mental health is something I believe in the future we can prevent and not have to cure.
So for instance, when you have a brain scan, you go, okay, that scan's got this abnormality or not. That's the only data field that I am seeing as a skilled technician. Yet a machine can take the whole lump of data that's behind there and then merge that with the other data set from the other scan. So we're merging functional MRIs with PET scans and giving greater insights as to what somebody's brain function may be doing, or giving a score on how likely they are to get dementia, or grading them with regards to brain behavior, or even building neural pathways. I mean, this stuff for me when I started medicine 30 years ago was, well, this is science fiction. But I can now see brain neural pathways in a little child with cerebral palsy, or in somebody who's just suffered a stroke, or someone who has mental illness. That is what data's doing for us now. Add in all of these other points of data, such as the wearables, but also some of the behavioral metrics and the way the environment's interacting with you, the way that you're interacting with the environment. It's going to give us incredible insights into how's your health going now.
Where do you see the future of happiness being?
I think it's a personal one. So realize that it's something that we can all have, and there's only one. This is the good news and this is the bad news. The bad news is, if people are having a bad day or a bad life, it's their responsibility. But the good news is, that it's also our responsibility to have an awesome life. So nothing can keep us from that. Nothing can keep us from that. No matter how dire our situation is, I can give you stories that would curl your hair, and yet people have turned out beautifully. So we can have beautiful lives, but we have to be the ones that proactively make that happen. No one else. And that will be, I think, to the listeners, that's what will be really important, is they take that challenge on and say, I am going to slowly begin to change my life. And 5% is not much of a change, but 5% and then 5% again and 5% again, after 20 times, you've changed 100%. So little changes, like with the tortoise, turn into great changes with time.